brother.
God,
what's up?
This is a good big party, man.
Yeah,
I
brother,
can dig it.
Solid. Right on.
There's too many of you crying. Brother, 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 there's far too many of you dying.
I think anyone who puckers up their lips and presses it against their boss's buttocks and then smooches is an ass kiss.
Go get him, Glenn. You know, show us what you can do.
I don't like newspapers. I don't care for inexactitude and shallowness.
Listen, hotshot, I'm going to tell you something right now. I don't care for you or for the putrid sludge you're troweling
out. First of all, it's a beautiful sunny day here in the great state of Minnesota.
You look like a rube, a well-scrubbed hustling rube.
You're just absolutely right.
I don't know, show
of hands. It must be nice to always believe you know better, to always think you're the smartest person in the room.
I don't know, show of hands. Show of hands.
Get off me!
Stroke the post, let's go.
This is your Revenge of the Cottonwood Seeds leader fan radio network.
It's snowing in Minnesota.
And KFAN. .com. 1 minute, 55 seconds past the hour, 3 o'clock.
That's sick.
That's so good.
That's sick, though.
Central Daylight Time. Welcome back. It is a Wednesday edition, midweek edition of the Bumper to Bumper program on a beautiful, I mean, this is ideal weather for this time of year, really for any time of year. A little better than snow, that's for sure, here in the Twin Cities of Minneapolis and St. Paul. I host the program. My name's Dan Barrero, former Inkstain Wretch. Newspaper of the Twin Cities. Guardzi is the producer of the program as well, and we'll be here all the way until 6:30 tonight, which is customary. It'll be a 3.5-hour tour today, and it'll include a lot of good stuff, I think. The Bradshaw and Brian KFAN text line might occasionally yield material that we might call upon. That does tend to happen. And in addition to that, we have a very good guest lineup. By the way, if you'd like to sponsor the guest lineup, as Borton Volvo did for many, many years, it's available right
now.
It is. It's open. It'd be a great opportunity. Prime real estate. Just get a hold of Chad Abbott. 952-417-3000. Is that our general number?
That's the front desk.
It's the front desk.
Yep, you can get wherever you need to go.
Get wherever you need to go. See if you can get something done. We would welcome you with open arms, correct?
Yes.
Similar to the way I think the Minnesota Timberwolves will be welcomed with open arms by their loyal fans when we do indeed have a Game 5 in the Western Conference Finals. You do know, I think, Guardzi, that the basketball world is rooting for us right now. And it has very little to do with necessarily admiring the club, you know, the signature run to this point of the team, having any kind of special affinity. I mean, they might have some affinity for Anthony Edwards, but it doesn't have to be that. Right now, it's this simple. We represent games.
They want something to do.
They're already depressed that, you know, once the NBA Finals ends, basketball is over until obviously next fall. Well, I should say international stage, that's not true, but in terms of the NBA. But there's this, you know, regardless of when this series was going to finish, the first date of Game 1 in Boston, NBA Finals, was set, right? Is it June 6th?
I think so.
I think it is. So if you're in the business of, you get into a rhythm during the postseason, you love this stuff, you love bouncing off of whatever action has taken place that night, the Wolves represent action. And that's why a lot of people, this is what's, I'm offering this up as a little bit of a public service because I'm worried that many of our fans are going to be heartened by the number of people today alone that I have heard say, you know what? They might just be the team that makes history. They just could be. It's going to happen sooner or later. Somebody down 0-3 in a series is going to figure out a way to do it. Yeah, we know it's never happened, but who's to say? And why not the Wolves, a higher seed than the team they're playing, number one seed for much of the season? It could happen. Now, do they mean it? Maybe in some cases they do, but in others it's, I want to believe it. They want to believe it because they want more games. They want not just a game five tomorrow night. They want a game six on, would it be Sunday? When is game six, if there is one?
Game six would be Saturday.
It is Saturday, so yes. We stick every other. Okay, mm-hmm. For some reason, I thought at the end maybe we went back to having that needing that Sunday game. Okay, so they want game six Saturday because then that's two more days of being able to talk about this stuff, debate it, argue about it, and then they want, so game seven would be Monday night?
It would be.
Game seven
right here,
Monday night. Can you imagine?
No, I can't. I can't. I'd like to.
Would that, even though it's not to win the whole thing, would that be the closest to 87 and 91
yes.
we've come to in this town?
Definitely.
I think it would.
Yes.
Wouldn't it?
Yes.
After, you know, losing the first three, after being down, obviously, 3-2 against Denver, the defending world champions, can you imagine the buildup? Now, I did hear, I bring all this up because I don't want you to get too aroused. Like, yeah, why can't we? And I'm not here to say it can't be done, but I am here to say you got to read the tea leaves and you got to read between the lines. And a lot of the people who are throwing it out there is, yeah, really good possibility. They want to believe it because, as I said, they just want more action. And so I'm not ripping them, but that's what's kind of inspiring them. Now, I will add, there's some fair analysis here that is also going into the intrigue of the possibility of the Wolves really, you know, carrying this thing forward and at least getting it to six or perhaps seven. So when you're the higher seed, well, let me give you the example, the best example to make the point. Pacers were also down. They found themselves down earlier this week, 0-3, correct? Just like the Wolves.
Yep.
They get to game four knowing that even if they win game four, they then have to go to Boston for game five. Kind of daunting in of itself. And they also know that if somehow they can carry it forward, two of the last three games that they'd have to win in this miracle, unprecedented comeback would be at the Boston Garden, okay? The Wolves, because they are a higher seed, are in the exact opposite position. They knew, even last night before they played, and we kind of alluded to this, talked about it, if they win game four, they're not staying in Dallas for game five. They're coming back here to the Anthill for game five, and they also know if somehow they win that one and then shock the world, when allegedly all the pressure would shift to Dallas to win it at home at game six, they get another game at home in game seven, two of the last three at home. Mentally, and I think psychologically,
there is a huge difference
between those two things. And I had hopes for Mike Conley today. It doesn't look like it's going to happen.
Does not.
Okay. Maybe that's part of what inspired him to say to Johnny Athletic, we're going to shock the world. Because he knows all of this, right? He's got to know. In fact, I think I heard Double T allude to this on Saturday on In the Zone, that, look, go to Dallas and win a game. Win a game. He didn't put it on the basis of win two to bring it back. Win a game knowing you're going to get back here for five, and your odds are still long. But it there's more than a glimmer in that situation. Is it likely you're going to lose in the same series three times at home? Psychologically, I think you can convince yourself, if you remember the Timberwolves, to say, well, no, that's not. We're not going to let that happen. We're not going to go 0-3 at home in this particular series. So I assume brighter minds than mine are working at Target Center vigilantly right now to find a way to make the Cottonwood seed part of the scenery.
Cascade from the rafters.
Yeah, so can you responsibly drop either what looks like cottonwood seeds or are cottonwood seeds from the roof to get into the Charles Barkley notion last night that we don't want to come back to Minnesota because it's snowing in Minnesota, when clearly somebody sent him a viral video. It looked like it was from a Twins game.
Yep.
Of what did, from a distance, if you didn't know the calendar, look like a blizzard. But it wasn't a blizzard of snow. It was a blizzard of cottonwood seeds. Is that correct?
Yes, that's exactly what it was. Right. I'm just wondering, did he only use the skyways for the first 4 days that he was here last week? I mean, it was like 70 degrees all of last week. Where do they think we live? It's very strange. I would imagine they could do some type of confetti, especially over the TNT set.
Yeah, that's for
from
sure.
The Raptors.
Well, my guess
and
is
just drop
that's
it.
True. And knowing the sense of humor that the TNT behind the scenes production people have,
they're on it.
They're on it. They want it too, right?
Even the tweets last night on it were brilliant.
Probably less easier to pull off when they're in their own studios, right? Let's be honest about the real reason. See, this is how it works with Charles compared to all those other NBA folks I'd mentioned earlier who want this thing to continue so there's not this huge gap between the end of this series and the start of the NBA Finals. Charles wants to go home.
He's ready to be done.
Yeah, Charles, and this is part of why Charles is so good. He doesn't need it. He doesn't live for it. He's ready. He's going to root for whatever team is up 3-0. Right? That's it for him. It's got nothing, really very little to do with whether it's snowing in Minnesota. It's, I just want to be done so I can go back to doing the two things I love to do, golf and fish, right? That's what he does. That's what he says.
He says nobody is better at doing nothing than him. In the entire world, he said no one is better at doing nothing than he is.
Yeah, so I hope we can come up with something because I was reminded today, we have had... In the history of Minnesota, it has snowed in June. In May, I should say,
yes.
And June.
Recently.
The only month it has never snowed, at least on record in Minnesota, I believe, is July.
For now.
So it has snowed in August?
I guess. I don't remember it.
We've had a couple cold state fairs.
Yeah.
To go back far enough.
Yeah.
It got a little bit chilly.
We named a tsunami in May. I remember that.
Did we?
It wasn't a huge snowstorm, but the fact that it was May,
yeah.
We felt like we had to.
They drop fake snow at Vikings games at U.S. Bank Stadium all the time. Don't know why Target Center.
This is very.
Also. Is that true?
Yeah, I would. I can't confirm that, but it makes sense.
Is it? Do they run into risks about actually contributing to people's breathing problems if they already have breathing problems, and then do they have to worry about lawsuits?
If it's actually cottonwood, yeah. But if it's just something that looks like fake
looks
snow,
like fake snow,
I'm sure you can find a safe way to do that.
You got to do it, don't you?
Yes.
You got to do it.
Yes.
Even though, I mean, he's not participating.
Santa needs to be there tomorrow.
He's larger than life.
Yeah, true. Like we got to do all the winter bits.
Got to have fun with it.
We're wearing white, I'm sure.
That's for sure. All right. A great guest lineup will include Sam Mitchell at the bottom of this hour. Tom Crean, the college coach of Anthony Edwards, who Anthony last night gave a shout out to Tom Crean. Again, we had him on a few weeks ago. He was terrific. And so we're going to catch up with him at 4:30. Kessler is back from San Diego. He'll file a live report in studio at 5:30 as well. There is so much to go over regarding Game 4 of this series, and we'll have time to cover each and every inch of it. But believe it or not, when we come back, I am going to offer up the bumper-to-bumper. I never thought I'd say it or even think it. The bumper-to-bumper seal of approval for Draymond Green. Is that possible? I think it is. Bumper to Bumper is the name of the program. We have been more than a little bit critical of Draymond Green. He's earned, I think, most of that savagery. And I stand behind it. I'm not here today to do the Sarwanga backpedal on any of it. But, you know, FISA rule, fairness and savagery. I did sort of wake up with a start last night when I heard a couple comments from the same Day-Day, Draymond Green, still on the TNT set, regarding one aspect of the Wolves, what was it, five-point victory?
105-100.
105-100 in game number four. Let's listen to what Day-Day had to say.
Looking for is for the Minnesota Bigs to set the tone like they did tonight. I was just laughing about Derek Jones and Rudy Gobert. But if you actually watch the game within the game, Rudy Gobert was in a lot of those tonight. He was chucking everybody. He chucked Derek Jones right there. He chucked Kyrie a couple times. He came to the lane. He was chucking everybody. Started that first half, and it set a tone for those guys. They were able to then stop them defensively and take advantage of their size.
It's the Bumper to Bumper seal of approval.
Now, let's be clear about something. We know the number one reason the Wolves did win last night, 105-100. It's what took place in winning time, what we call, what Magic Johnson calls winning time, and we've adopted it on this show and defined it at different stages in each of these games. But in each case, it's when the Wolves either were ahead or tied. And in the first three games in winning time, as we talked extensively yesterday, the Wolves were outscored 30-6. Last night in winning time, 10-10. Further proof that you don't even have to necessarily win the battle. You just have to, in this case, stalemate the battle, which means you have to hit two or three shots. That's it. You just have to hit enough shots to fend them off, because it was a five-point lead with 3:55 to go, 95-90, and it was a five-point lead at the end of the game, right? 105-100. That's more important. We're going to get into all what that's all about, Cat's revival, what Anthony did, what Slow-Mo did. It's all going to get covered today, I promise you. But I do believe that I don't know how consciously Rudy was doing this, if it was more he was just cranky.
Yeah.
Or he deliberately said, I'm going to knock people a little bit. I'm not going to get ridiculous with it, but I'm not going to apologize for some contact. And I think it's a good thing. I think it felt like it was annoying Luka a little. I do. I think there were a couple times where he was pissed. Then there was the one time where Slow-Mo ends up double teaming, and almost he can kind of see that. I think in that situation, Luka's not really looking at him. So he said, oh, I'll just come up here as if I'm just trying to make my presence known. And it was another good hard hit. Part of, I think, a growing team, a new team, getting taken seriously is threading that needle of not doing really cheap stuff, but doing hard stuff and saying, we're not messing around. And if every once in a while we rattle your bones a little bit, we're going to rattle your bones a little bit. Now, you know, can do any one of those things change everything? No. But I do think they set a tone. And I think Draymond, that's obvious, that's all that Draymond ever wants to think about. So that's, you know, that's amusing in of itself. But in this case, I think he's onto something. I think there's something there that then maybe makes it a little bit easier for some other players to do it, where you go, because one of the raps on Rudy has been, he is playing a little bit too soft. And there are times, I mean, he's not a really highly physical player, right? But last night I thought there was a little bit more of, I don't give a damn anymore. If I knock somebody, if I happen to, you know, run into somebody on the way back across to the other side of the court, the other end of the court, I'm going to do it. And maybe it throws somebody off their game. Maybe it is a message to the teammates to say, let's bleep and go after this. Let's not apologize. Let's not always be grinning and smiling with these guys, even if the way it's supposed to work in the NBA now is we're all one big fraternity.
I think it was Van Gundy or Harlan that even said, you can tell there's some animosity between Gobert and Luka.
And it's going to get ratchet. Trust me, it's game be five, messy. It's going to be ratcheted up big time.
Well, it's going to be messy because of, you mentioned Kyle Anderson, when Luka turns around and acts like Kyle Anderson assaulted
molested him. Molested him, yes.
Which was absurd.
Right.
He fouled him, of course, but he didn't do anything malignant. It wasn't mean. It wasn't vicious. It wasn't, you know, Kurt Rambis clothesline.
But his reaction?
Absurd.
Reaction absurd, but that's exactly for the Wolves what you want. If that, you know, he ends up with a triple-double. He didn't shoot very well, though.
Right.
So, I mean, we'll never know what goes into the concoction in terms of the percentages. How much is this? How much is that? But I like seeing it. I thought there hadn't been enough of it.
Yeah.
They were too comfortable.
Yep.
There's a lot of ways to do it, and you don't have to be, I'm not talking about bully ball or playing out of character, but just standing your ground and saying, I'll take the hit here a little bit, and if I got a little extra nudge in there, I'm gonna do it. This is the National Basketball Association.
And there's, like you said, a million things to talk about the game, but the fact that they were able to start so well and build a lead that they ended up squandering because everybody was in foul trouble, and then it felt like a win that they were tied at halftime because of the lineup they had the last 3 minutes. They were building that lead because everybody was very physical defensively.
Definitely.
They made things very, very difficult on Dallas. They were not in that rhythm that we've seen them be in for much of the series. And that allowed them to go up by 12 at one point, which, of course, in Wolvesian fashion, should have been more multiple times.
No question.
Or at least should have been.
There was an Ant turnover in there again where he lost the ball in the lane where I was just screaming.
Yeah.
Oh, my God. It's happening again.
And so, and there were two in the fourth quarter back to back that led Dallas back
in the
game. So in Wolvesian fashion, it wasn't as clean as it needed to be. But they had the start they needed defensively and physically. And I think the message sending that we are going to try to extend this thing.
Yes.
Like, we aren't just going to let you have your night like you want to have here. We're going to try to make you come back to snowy Minnesota if we can.
Yes, exactly. Exactly it. So, by the way, Bradshaw and Brian, KFAN text line. We got a lot of good texts already coming in at 64686. And we will we'll definitely weave those into the fabric of the program as the day goes on. Kessler, as I mentioned, in studio at 5:30. We'll see if he's back on the bandwagon now, because he kind of left, right? He was in San Diego for a few days.
Yep.
Tom Crean, who coached Anthony Edwards at the University of Georgia, will make his second visit on the program in recent weeks. We had a good conversation with him last time. Lots has happened since, right? But his name came up after the game with Ant, who once again had a terrific Abbott and Costello moment with Cat, in which Cat was responding to a question about fouling out, and Ant made sure to stick the needle in. Say, "Yeah, you fouled out. What'd I tell you? What'd I tell you about fouls?" And then, of course, Cat said, "Well, you had five fouls, but I didn't foul out," which was classic as well. It's turned into a nice little back and forth between the two of them, in which once again Anthony Edwards proves rather fearless for sure. Let's do this. Let's stay on schedule. We do have, I mentioned Kessler, I mentioned Crean, but when we come back, another visit, one in an endless series of excellent visits we've had. This has been great during this Wolves run. Sam Mitchell is going to join us. We'll get his reaction to game four, what he thought changed, and whether he thinks the impossible is indeed possible. All that's next. Man.
Whether I miss it or make it, I can live with that. And I haven't been doing that the last three games of this series. I've been going to the corner and not shooting the ball and not being aggressive. And, that won't happen anymore. Anytime late in the fourth, I'm going to shoot it every time.
Anthony Edwards, after the Wolves 105-100 game four victory. Interesting bit of intel, Guardsy, coming in from Jen in Golden Valley. Finchie is getting a haircut at the same salon I'm at right now. Finchie, I guess.
Hand him the phone, Jen.
Do you think that's a sign that Finchie's saying, man, we're going to be in front of the cameras for a while now.
Yeah.
I got to make sure I look properly coiffed. Is that the word?
Coiffed is a word, yep. If I'm going to jump into the huddle like I did last night.
How about that?
I got to have my hair a little bit more ready to go.
Got the technical last night. Everybody talked about that.
Yep.
Hair on fire and the team allegedly was inspired by it. I don't remember when was that? Was that third quarter or fourth?
That was third, because that was when Cat threw his elbow into the chin of whoever was guarding him. I can't remember. PJ Washington, maybe?
Right.
I'm pretty sure it was Cat's fifth foul where he got the tech.
I got a text into Mitchell. We can't get a hold of Sam right now, so I've asked him to hit the hotline, so hopefully he'll call in the next minute or two. He's been on a pretty good roll for us, but every once in a while something comes up. So I hope we can continue to get him on at some point during the next half hour. Tom Crean at 4:30, and Kessler is scheduled to join at 5:30 tonight. There was a subtle, but I think one of the things we talked about yesterday is Finchie, just have a game where you coach the hell out of him. And it's always easier after the fact when you win the game to say, well, yeah, that's he did this, this, and this, and look what happened. But I do think there were some little subtle wrinkles that were effective and that did give Dallas something else to think about. And I start with the decision to change defensive assignments, at least at the start of the game. So when the series began, it was Anthony saying, I'll raise my hand, I will guard Kyrie, right? And it was, I believe, Jaden on Luka. So the Wolves make a decision last night, or Finchie makes a decision, maybe in consultation with his associates, his staff. So, well, maybe we move Jaden to Kyrie. And then, conversely, at least at the start, it's going to be Anthony on Luka. Although eventually other people like Slow-Mo get involved there, etc. And he was asked, okay, well, what was that all about? And he basically admitted, well, you know, we're down 0-3. Let's just start throwing some stuff out. But I do think there's a logic to it, because this is the way I took it. Well, what we're learning is no matter who we put on Luka, he's going to get what he's going to get. And if he doesn't score as frequently as we're accustomed to, or he's accustomed to, it might just be more that his shot didn't go in. And that's a lot of what we saw to a certain extent last night. But maybe it's the old deal of, we've said all along that one of these guys is going to go off. Luka's got the ball in his hands more than anybody, including Kyrie, so it's probably going to be him. So let's not even pretend that we're going to be able to stop that. Let's instead move our best defender with a huge height advantage there, huge height advantage over Kyrie, over to Kyrie, and let's see how Kyrie handles it. We're giving him a little bit of a different look. And I don't think Kyrie handled it all that well.
No.
At all.
No. Nope.
I don't think he did not look as into it as we have seen. Now, is that coincidence? I don't know. But I like the switch. I think you go back to it. I really do. I think, you know, something works a little bit. Let's keep trying it until they prove that they come back and in some way burn us by changing that matchup. I thought that was really smart. And an example of what we're saying is just give the other team something else different to think about. And in this case, let's face it, we know that the straws that stir the drink are those two, right? That's been the talk of this whole tournament. And I don't have, I had the box score, but I can't find it.
What do you need?
What were Kyrie's final numbers?
He was 6 of 18 from the floor, 1 of 6 from 3. He only got to the line 3 times, made all
That's
of them.
That's it. That's and great work on them, on him.
16 points, 4 assists, and 2 rebounds.
Now, I also believe that they're double teaming, the fancier term these days is blitzing, of Luka was a lot better, because I thought it was more aggressive. I thought it was less halfway-ish. And I thought, once again, does it stop him? No. Does it make him give up the ball? You know, often Luka only gives up the ball when he's ready to, because he thinks he's got an opening he's found. And he did some of that. He always does. He's a great passer. But there are a few times where I thought they forced him to give it up in situations where there wasn't a big advantage to the guy he was throwing it to.
Right.
And so I liked the blitzing better. I thought it was, like I said, it was It was smarter, and it just felt more forceful and less half-hearted. Those, to me, were two of the biggest adjustments that were made. You know, we talked before yesterday. The Wolves' big two had been outscored by the Mavericks' big two by 70 points through the first three games. Last night, Wolves' big two, 54, Kyrie and Luka, 44. I mean, case closed. You're back to, well, yeah, you don't really have, you can, there's a lot of other stuff we've already talked about, but that is pretty much changes everything. And I felt all along, I don't even expect you to match their points. You just can't get blown out by an average, what's 70 divided by 3? Over 20.
Yeah.
It's over 20 a game. You can't be outscored. Your big two can't be outscored by over 20 a game, correct?
Right. And even putting Ant on Luka is still obviously a big challenging defensive assignment, but it's not the same as chasing Kyrie all over the place.
Yes.
And I think that's a good spot for Jaden, because the whole point of Ant was you want to try to give him some kind of breaks because of what you're asking him to do offensively.
Correct.
You can't just have him running around and guarding his ass off for 40 minutes and, oh, by the way,
yes,
try to carry us down here.
And that's why they mixed it up. But yeah.
Yeah.
Right.
But I like having, it's a break in a way in that you got to be physical and you got to be there, but you're not chasing him corner to corner. He's going to run you off screens, but you don't
Kyrie moves a lot more.
A ton.
No question.
And you got to stay with them the whole time.
You could see that from the start of the series, from game one, that Ant was going, oh, my God.
Yeah, he was quick.
That's part of why I think he got tired. I don't think he was ready for all those moves. So I thought that was a brilliant touch. And how much of Kyrie's struggles were self-induced and how much of it were, you know, the change, I don't know. But I definitely like it. I mean, let's be clear about something. There is, I don't think any, in terms of guarding Luka, we don't have anybody, who's the Oklahoma City guy, is it Dort,
guarded Dort.
Him? I mean, that guy is built like a tank, okay? He might have a chance to do something physically that might bother Luka, and he did from time to time. We don't really have, none of our defenders are built that way, right? They're not wired that way. So you say, all right, well, that there's no point. We'll try to blitz him to take the ball out of his hands a little bit, but we're not going to stop him. But if we can stop Kyrie, or if we can bug Kyrie more, with a great deal of length, that's a different look. And I think that's part of what indeed took place. We have found Sam Mitchell. He has called the hotline, joining us via the Connecticut Water Systems hotline as well. We were just talking while we were trying to find you about, I thought, a subtle but effective defensive assignment change that Finchie kind of admitted they went to out of desperation, like, well, we got to just try something different. We're down 3-0. Let's see what we can do. And that was to move Jaden over to Kyrie and had several people, but starting with Ant, on Luka. And it almost, to me, Sam, came off as, look, Luka's going to Luka. But what we got to try to do is not let both of them go off at various times to the degree they have. So let's put some real length on Kyrie. This way Ant doesn't have to chase him everywhere, because Kyrie, as you know, moves a lot more across the court than Luka. And Kyrie struggled offensively. I kind of like that switch. What did you make of it?
I loved it. Because at some point, you got to give both of those guys. Look, if both of those guys have great games, you're probably going to lose.
Yep.
The same for the Timberwolves. If Anthony Edwards and Karl Anthony Towns both have big games, the Timberwolves are probably going to win. What happened the other night? Anthony Edwards played well. Karl Anthony Towns finally found his offense. He did what he do best, score the basketball. They won. And so I think what Coach French and the rest of the staff got to do is they got to look. You just got to throw different guys at Luka to try to keep him off balance. He's going to get his 35. You know why, Dan? Because he's going to shoot enough until he gets 35.
Yeah.
Because think about it. There isn't a shot that he's not allowed to take. Luka came down. I watched the game. The first two or three shots of the game he took, it was almost like he was feeling himself out.
Mm-hmm.
He just kind of tossed them up there. And then all of a sudden, he kind of got going. Now, only superstars on that team can do that, right? Kind of throw away the first two or three possessions and then until they kind of find their rhythm. Well, the Wolves did a great thing. Keep putting length on Kyrie, because what happened is, what Anthony Edwards didn't understand was, if you're chasing Kyrie, who's used to moving without the ball and running like that, and Anthony's not, you're going to run out of gas in the fourth quarter. And I think what the Wolves did, Anthony had some energy. Carl had some energy at the end of the game. Carl stepped up after he started driving to the basket. Mm-hmm. He saw some shots go down. He made some, got some free throws. And all of a sudden, the three balls started falling. And I think in this series, Dan, and I said it before, I'll say it again, Carl has to dominate from inside out like Anthony Edwards has to. It's going to come down to if Carl Anthony Towns and Anthony Edwards can outplay Luka and Kyrie. It's just that simple. That's what the playoffs, when you get to the semifinals and the championship, it's about your best players outplaying the other team's best players. Because you can't hide. No. Think about it, Dan. You can't hide anybody now.
No, that's very true. I would argue that I don't think necessarily the Wolves have to, the Wolves Big Two has to outscore them. They just have to hang with them. I really do, because the first three games, Sam, they were, wasn't just they were outscored, they were outscored by 70. So in this case, it was 54-44, the Wolves Big Two. And so it's obviously better if you can actually, you know, end up with more points than they do. But if they play somewhat even, given what else the Wolves have, then I think they're in good shape. But the first three games, largely because of Cat's, you know, shooting woes, his slump, it wasn't even, it's got to be close at the very least, right?
Absolutely. It has to be close because, again, if your others can outplay their others, that's a huge advantage. I mean, that could be the difference in the game. But if your two stars can outplay the other team's two stars, Dan, think of it this way. You don't want it to come down to the role players. Because now it depends on who's at home.
Right.
Because role players always play better. Now, that may suit you great in game five, but that may not fare too well for you in game six when you're back in Dallas. And Jones and other got P.J. Washington, those guys play with confidence. So at the end of the day, what you want to happen, you want your best players, because their game is supposed to translate. Their game is supposed to travel. Right? It shouldn't matter where arena you're in. For Kyrie Irving or Anthony Edwards.
Good point.
That game is supposed to transfer. So at the end of the day, when you get to this point, if you're relying on your role players, we all know role players, they better play better at home. So you better hope you're at home. And since the Wolves are coming home, that's a great scenario. But guess what? Game six is in Dallas. So I would feel much better if I know Carl has found his rhythm and Anthony continues to build off the game four like last
night. That's a very fair point. So if we're ranking, is Cat's reemergence, what do you have? I think 3 3-pointers in the fourth quarter. His reemergence, is that at the top of the list as to why we're sitting here talking about that there will be a game five?
Hey, Dan, you better listen to Anthony Edwards. You know, he says some outrageous things, but normally the things that he say, the truth is within him.
Yeah.
What has he been saying all series? We go as Carl Anthony Towns go.
Yeah.
Right, he is that X factor. When Carl brings his A game offensively, look, we can want Carl to be rooted defensively. We could talk about, you know, matchups and all this, but at the end of the day, Carl's got to do what he does best. They didn't pay Carl over $200 million to be a great defender. They paid him that because he could put the ball in the basket. When he's putting the ball in the basket like he did last night, it opens everything up for everyone else. The game is easier. Because Carl can score in multiple ways. He can knock down free throws. Think about it. He's an 80%+ free throw shooter. When he's playing well, he's almost a 40% three-point shooter, and he's way over a 50% field goal shooter. So when he's rolling, and then who are you going to match up against him? You got to put a big body on Rudy just to keep him off the offensive glass. So that leaves P.J. Washington. And I know this for a fact. If you put Carl Anthony Towns on that elbow or on the block, P.J. Washington can't guard
it. Yeah, I think that's very, very true. What did you make of the – well, it's interesting because we've been very hard on this show on Draymond. I actually gave him some props last night because I thought he brought up a legitimate point. You can speak to this a lot better than I do, can, because you can tell me whether we make this stuff up, whether this matters. But what Draymond brought up last night was – hey, I kind of like the fact Rudy was knocking people around a little bit or didn't seem to want to get out of the way if he's coming down the court. And if he hammers somebody a little bit, you know, a little cheap, but not anything that rises to the level of real goonery or anything like that. And I think he's right, because Slow-Mo ended up knocking Luka once, which seemed to annoy Luka. I do think it was time and helpful for the Wolves to even though, again, they're not the bad boys, that to sort of establish something defensively to try to get a try to annoy those guys a little bit and say we're here to try to get into you more than we have before. That can be helpful. What do you think?
I think that's a positive. You know, there's a fine line between playing tough and dirty.
Right.
As long as you don't cross that line to being dirty, tough is all fair and game. The players should understand this. And the Dallas Mavericks should understand, when you have a team down 3-1, if they have any pride, if they felt like they had any chance of beating you, they're going to step up and they're going to play. They're going to bring it to you each and every play. So the Wolves played like they were supposed to play, a desperate team. Yeah. Carl Anthony Towns said it after the game. They have to play desperate every possession. Every possession, they got to play desperate. They got to sell out on every possession because now they've put themselves in position to where they can't make any mistakes, right? They got to win every single possession, and that's just got to be the mindset. And Dan, I'm telling you, if the Boston Celtics can win 3 in a row, I think the Timberwolves can. I think that I feel pretty confident, and I think you will agree they can win game 5 at home.
Yes.
It's not like we're talking about they can't win game 5. The question is, can they hold it together and win a game 6 back in Dallas and force a game 7 at home?
That's
the question.
That's 100% the question. And I want to go there next because I heard Tim Legler talk about this. You know Tim, I think, pretty well, that the big difference between the Pacers being down 0-3 and the Wolves was that the Pacers knew, even if they won game 4, they got to go to Boston for game 5. Wolves knew, hey, if we can win one game here now to extend it, we get to go home, and then you say, all right, 3-2, let's see if it puts some pressure on Dallas. And I think that's why I'm hearing, even from a lot of people nationally, they don't think it's outrageous that this thing could go 7. The hard part, I think, which you could speak to, is when you have two fairly evenly matched teams, just because of luck, because of ups and downs, man, to expect to actually pull off something that's never been pulled off in the history of the league, is that still too much to ask?
Dan, this is your thought process. Don't worry about pulling off something that's never been done in the history of the league. All you got to do is win the next game.
Yeah.
If you start trying to think about doing something that no one else has done, then it becomes undaunting. Then it becomes overwhelming.
Yeah.
All you got to focus on is winning tomorrow. That's it. That's it. You win tomorrow, and then the next day I take care of itself. So if I'm the Wolves, I'm sure they're going to be in this mindset. Just win tomorrow, man. Just come out. You're at home. You've won. You've been a great team all year. You're supposed to win game 5 at home. If you're a championship caliber team, you are supposed to win that game at home. And then game 6, you're just going to have to bring it. Because, again, Dallas, if they lose game 5, they're going to bring it in game 6. Because for them, they understand they don't want a game 7 in Minneapolis. Because they'll feel like they will have blown the series. So if you're the Wolves, you get game 5, all the pressure.
Yep.
Shifts to Dallas for game 6. I mean, the whole kitchen sink. But then guess what, Dan? You get game 6, all the pressure shifts to you now because now you done bust your ass to get it back to game 7 at home. And people are saying, well, you can't blow it now. So that's what I love about it, Dan. The pressure is shifts from city to city based on where you are and what you do at that time.
Yeah, and remember, as you said, the two of the last 3 games of this series, if it goes the distance, are here. That's the other,
that's right.
I think you can, the Wolves can hold on to. Two other quick points. Is there a way to convince Carl to not commit stupid fouls?
Look, I just think the players, the coaching staff, they just got to keep reiterating, keep showing the film, keep talking to him, keep making him understand how important he is. We've seen it. When Carl doesn't play well, they don't win, period. When Carl plays well, it gives him the best opportunity to win. So if you're Carl at the Towns, any foul 30 feet from the basket, I would tell him, anytime you could commit a reach-in foul, and I would say it jokingly, anytime you commit a reach-in foul 30 feet from the basket for any reason at all, just take $100,000 and put it in the dumb jar. We're going to start a dumb foul
there
jar.
There you go.
Okay?
I like it.
And for the whole team, Anybody who commits a foul 30 feet from the basket, especially if it's a foul that puts the team on the free throw line, that's even double. Because those are just dumb things that you cannot do in the playoffs. 100%. Those are the type of things that get you beat. It's not the spectacular plays. It's the team that don't do the dumb thing and give the other team easy baskets. And easy baskets is free throws.
Is there a way, offensively, with the way the Wolves play offense, to make Luka work harder on defense than he has? Because, I mean, there's a lot of talk about that on the TV broadcast last night. Often he's against Jaden, and they got, you know, their offense. Jaden basically stands in the corner a lot of times for 8 seconds. And it does seem like, my God, you know, their guys, certainly Luka, do not have to work as hard as the Wolves' main two guys defensively. Is there a way to do anything about this?
Dan, I'm going to say this, and don't take this the wrong way. As an unemployed coach, and you got a bunch of unemployed coaches on TV and radio talking about all these great ways to stop Luka.
Yes.
Guess what? If they knew how, they wouldn't be unemployed. And for the coaches who are employed and trying to do it right now, yeah, they can't figure it out. You can't, Dan.
Yeah.
I mean, when you watch him play, he's not a great athlete. Hell, he don't even look like he's in shape. Luka looked like the guy that shows up on Saturday morning, mid-morning, with a beer in his hand after drinking all night the night before. And this drive comes up and shows you and just gives you 40.
Yeah.
You can't speed him up. You can't block his shot. He knows how to use angles. He knows how to use his body. He understands that he can take any shot without question. So he has the ultimate green light. So no, Dan, the only thing you could do against Luka is try to make him shoot a bad percentage.
Which he did,
period.
I think, last night. Well,
which
no,
he did.
But what about on the other side of the court? Can you make him have to expend more energy than I think the Wolves have made him expend as a defensive player?
Dan, I'm going to say this, and it sounds kind of bad and stupid as a coach. But Luka's the type, when he does an ole on defense as a coach, you say, okay, I know he'll get it back 3 or 4 times on the other end. It's some players that you could just live with that with. And he's that guy. Think about it. You can attack Luka, but it was a thing that's sneaky about Luka. You can go at Luka to a point, and then he kind of gets it in his mind that he's going to stop you.
Mm-hmm.
He's a smarter defender than what you think, and he knows how to use that big body and that strength to kind of defend you. Now, I'm not saying he's a great defender, but he at least have shown you that if you keep trying to go at him, he'll give you the effort to stop him. But this is the problem, Dan. If you're going at Luka one-on-one, what are you going to do against him on the back end?
Yeah,
because he don't care.
Yeah, he doesn't.
Right.
You're right.
And it kind of takes you out of what you're trying to do.
That's the issue.
By attacking him.
Yep.
And it doesn't bother Dallas team when Luka goes one-on-one. But it kills your team, because if you're not scoring, your guys are looking at you sideways. And Dallas, Luka takes 5 in a row and missed 5 in a row. You know what they say to Luka? Shoot the next 5.
Lastly, and you've told us this before, nothing replaces shot making. If you look at winning time in the first 3 games of this series, in which the Wolves led, by the way, in all of these games, outscored, what were the numbers I had in front of me here? 10-3, 6-0, 14-3. And last night, they're up 5 with 3:55 to go. Same position they've basically been in every game. It's 10-10 the rest of the way. And that's all it takes. It doesn't even have to be that you got to heavily outscore them, but you have to make some shots, right? I mean, that's what I think Carl represented. And Ant had a great two-pointer, I thought, where he used Rudy's screens really effectively to find an opening. That's where I think he's growing a little bit as an offensive player. But that's the moral, isn't it? Just match them, or try to match them with making some shots. But you have to make a few shots, right? You have to do it.
Man, your best players got to outplay the other team. Last night, which 2 best players outperformed?
Well, yeah, no question.
Okay, once again, in the previous 3 games,
right?
The Mavericks. If Carl Anthony Towns, Dallas is worried right now, because they know if they don't get... Look, they kind of know game 5, you can talk about, well, we should win, but it ain't like you're the Pacers. The Wolves are good.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, they had a chance to finish. They finished 1 game out of first place in the West.
Yep.
They beat Denver. They beat them 3 times in Denver. So Jason Kidd and Dallas know that they were very fortunate to win those first three games. They now know they're in a dog fight because they know the Timberwolves are going to have confidence. They're going to come out in game five. The crowd's going to be behind them. Dallas know there's a better than 55% chance that Dallas is going to lose that game. They understand that.
Yeah.
So the thing that they understand is, hey, if that game gets out of hand early, don't be surprised. If the Wolves are up 14 or 15 early in that fourth quarter, don't be surprised to see Jason Kidd pull his starters to make sure they got everything left in the tank for game six, because that's going to be their game seven. They're going to throw everything into game six if they don't get game five tomorrow.
Yeah, well, that's basically what Denver did. When the Wolves blew out Denver in game six, Malone pulled everybody because it was such a – I mean, that was an extreme example of what you're talking about. But, yeah, that would not surprise me at all. Although, as you say, then that's the beauty of it. The pressure would shift. But then, as you also say, if you actually pull it off and it's seven – Garzi and I were talking about this. So can you imagine the atmosphere in this building? If they have a chance to make history, that kind of history,
it's going to be unbelievable.
It'd be unbelievable, but I don't want to say I'm worried we're getting fans too riled up and too stoked because this is not easy to do.
No, Dan, it's not, but it's also not impossible. And Dan, guess what? It's going to happen one day.
Yeah,
it's going to happen.
Right.
You know that.
Right.
It's going to happen. Somebody broke Kareem Abdul-Jabbar's scoring record. People say that never happened. Somebody broke Lou Gehrig's consecutive games played, 2,000 and some baseball games in a row.
Right.
Somebody did it.
Yeah.
Somebody's going to be down 0-3. And think about it, Dad. You know why this is going to happen? Because it almost happened last year.
That's true.
Look how close it came to happening last year. And to be honest with you, it should have happened. Boston on paper were a much better team than Miami. They should have came back and won those.
Well, plus, didn't what's his name get hurt early in that game? I thought who's
Tatum there? Did.
Yeah, Tatum
he
did.
Sure
didn't
did.
He? Yeah,
he kind of sat a slice, kind of came down awkward on his ankle.
Right, right.
And he was never the same the rest of the game.
Very true. All right, my friend.
So it's going to happen.
It's going to happen. Are you flat out guaranteeing it? Conley already told Johnny Krasinski, our guy, before the game. This was after the game three loss. Johnny, get your notebook ready. Because you're gonna have a hell of a story to write. We're gonna make history. Conley said it. It's on the record.
You're supposed to feel that way.
Yeah, you got to.
You're
don't
supposed
you?
To feel that way.
Yeah,
yeah. And guess what? They believe it. You know, a lot of people say it, but if you're the Wolves, why don't you believe? Dude, we beat Denver three times in Denver. Now let's go back before the start of the season. If somebody would have told you for the Timberwolves to advance to the Western Conference Finals in the press conference of day one. Of training camp, that you would have, how much money would you bet that the Wolves would have to go into Denver and beat them three times to advance to the West? How much, what would you have said? Hold on, let me call my broker. Let me sell my house. Let me get every scratch, every dime that I can get together because I'm betting the farm. Right?
Yeah, there's no question.
There is no way you would have thought Minnesota could beat Denver three times in Denver.
No,
nobody would have.
No.
All my children would be named Dan.
I don't. There's no question about that. There's no way that anybody could have predicted that it would go. This whole thing has gone the way it's gone. I'm just glad they didn't get swept because I think it would have left a bad taste in people's mouths. The fact that they are in a position where Game Five's here, and I think it was important to do it. I think they needed to sort of reassert themselves a little bit. As good as it has been up until now, I really do. I think you and I talked on and off air a lot. The way they finished those first three games did bug me on a lot of levels, and I think it was an important step, you know, to not just meekly go down in four games.
Hey Dan, think about it from this standpoint: Phoenix Suns got swept. Yeah. Now you got KD, you got all these all time great players, right?
Yeah,
KD them got swept. LeBron got swept. You got all-time great, right? Give the Timberwolves credit. Their pride kicked in. What did Anthony Edwards say after the game? Man, I didn't want to get swept. I'm sorry. It's something about getting beat. There's another thing about when you get your ass beat four times in a row, especially in the Western Conference
Finals. Yeah.
You're telling me we've been this good all year and then we're this bad? when we get to the one series away from the finals, that's a hard pill to swallow, especially after you beat Denver, the team that everybody picked to repeat.
Do you think Charles is going to be shocked when he comes back here and finds out there really wasn't any snow falling here? It's just cottonwood seed stuff that flies around. Do you think he...
Dude, let me tell you, he ain't going to remember what he said from game to game.
That's true. He just wants to leave. He just wants to go home. We'll be in touch.
Hey, man, Chuck just wanted to be fine.
That's it.
All right, guys.
Thank you, Sam, as always. Appreciate you.
You're welcome.
Sam Mitchell, great stuff as always from him. We went a little long because we started a little bit long, but we'll get caught up. And we do have Tom Crean at 4:30. We've got the real Timberwolves superfan Kessler in studio at 5:30.